So, if you ever notice, I have chickens in a tree. Rosemary told me it was wrong, so she put a cardinal. She's like, chickens don't roast in trees. But my thing is, in my world, chickens roast in trees. So I want you to see this beautiful tree. And I tried to get a mustard seed, and then I was like, how am I going to show y'all mustard seed? The point is, I can't. If I had a mustard seed in my hand, you can't even see it. I figured out no way to actually show you a mustard seed. I put it in my hand and then realized there's enough curve you can't see it. Put it on the table and realized it's still too small to see. And yet when we think of a mustard seed and it being this giant bush that birds rest in, and God's talking about the kingdom, we just don't get it. But when we see it, and we go, can you imagine a tree this size coming from a seed that I couldn't even show you, it's so small. And today I want you to keep that image in your mind of this seed becoming this giant tree. We're in Mark chapter 4. And Jesus had just given the parable of the sower, and then he explained it to them. And then he talks about a lamb. And then he starts talking about the kingdom. And the kingdom of power. And I like the scripture reading on that because, you know, it's very clear. There is this power that cannot be overcome. There's this power that the gates of hell cannot conquer. There is this idea that something could be loosed in heaven and bound in heaven. And the power that the church has. We are in Mark chapter 4, starting in verse 26. And he said, the kingdom of God, that's the church. And he said, the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. Verse 30, he continues it and says, and he said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable shall we use for it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which when sown on the ground is the smallest of all the seeds. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his disciples, he explained everything. So he gives them this parable about the kingdom of God, and at first he says, it's like a man who plants, and you can plant it, and you know, you walk away. It's not like you dig the hole, you put the plant in there, and then you watch. None of us have that kind of patience. I get hungry in 30 minutes, so just imagine, you know, you plant the seed, and then you're waiting for it to grow. And that's not how we do it. We come back, we might water it. Here we don't need to, I got it. So we come back and we look at it. Nothing. We come back and look at it. Nothing. We don't even do anything. We come back and look at it. Nothing. And then slowly we start to see it do things. Nothing. We just watch it again. And then the whole idea of, you know, a whole field growing and all we're doing is just continuing to watch it. But yet we don't know how it's doing what it's doing. We don't know what it's doing what it's doing. We don't know when it will come. We don't know how big it will be. We know nothing. We just watch at a distance. And that first parable is this. The kingdom of God is a mystery. The kingdom of God is greater and bigger than we imagine it to be. And so he tells us the second parable. So we get the point. He says, let me tell you about the kingdom of God. It's a tiny seed that becomes a giant bush. Becomes a giant bush bigger than a mesquite tree. And you have birds come and they rest in it. And this tiny seed the bird could eat to not ever get full, would barely notice, becomes something so great that the birds can then make nests in it. And after he does this, he explains everything to his disciples. And so they know. They know what's going on. He's told them about this great power. And they're really confused. Verse 35. When they see it they go, whoa, that is that what you said? Who are you? Mark 4, starting in verse 35. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, let us go across to the other side. And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was, and other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a cushion. And they woke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Can you imagine it? They're sitting in a boat with Jesus who told them there's this great power. He's like, it's beyond your comprehension. All I can do is give you this. It's a seed. It becomes great. He takes them aside, explains everything to them. And then it happens. He told them all about this great power. He told them what can happen through faith in him. He told them about the church that's going to be so amazing. And then they see it. And they ask the obvious question. Who's this guy? I love this. Who then is this? Okay, you've been hanging out with Jesus. You've been spending time. He's been teaching you. You've been studying with him. You finally see something that's amazing. The seed becoming this giant tree. And you know, who is this? What is this? How is this happening? And he's just told them two parables that explained it. You don't know how it's happening. It's greater. It's bigger than you can imagine. It's bigger than you're going to grasp. And they see it and they say, who is this? How is it that Jesus can now control the universe? And I go back to that scripture reading where it speaks of being loosed and bound in heaven. And I got to thinking about how our prayers can't happen now. If I go into, I always think about interviews. I hate interviews worse than anything. It's the one thing I just dread. Because of those stupid questions. How do you make a peanut butter sandwich? What does that mean? And you're not supposed to ask, what does that mean? You're supposed to answer the question. I just ask what it means. And I think about this, and I think about praying before that, and I say, you know, God, you know, let this be effective. If this is what you want from me, let it be right. Let it be good when I go in this. Let me be honest, and let that be honest with me. And I pray this, and I don't even think about what I'm asking. Because to me, I'm just asking, in 5 minutes, can this be done? And in reality, what I'm asking God to do is change history. I'm asking God to go back 15 minutes ago when that person's driving in their car. I'm asking them to go back 2 days ago when they're thinking about this. When they're thinking about the questions they'll ask. When they're thinking about what they really want. I'm asking God to go back in history. And it's so weird that we will think about it and we'll go, God, I asked for this, and not realize how far he has to go back. And when he describes the power of the church in Matthew, what he does is he describes this whole loosening in heaven. Heaven where there's no time. And that nothing changes. He's the same God he was 5,000 years ago that he is yesterday. He's the same God tomorrow that he is today. And this one God who never changes has to change the past when I pray. And to him, time is nothing. And he gives this power to the church. He says that the gates of hell won't be able to stop you. You'll run the gates of hell. You will conquer hell. And we do this. Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? We ask God to do mighty things, and some of us honestly don't expect anything. We will pray lip service to our King. We will pray and we'll be like, God, if you can do something. Can the master of the universe, can the God who describes the church as a tiny seed that becomes so big that that same bird who wouldn't even stop to pick up that tiny seed is then putting his nest in that tree. Can that God do something? And we sit there and say, who is this God? Because we like hearing about God, and we like hearing about how he loves us, and hearing and hearing and hearing. And so many of us don't get the point that until you do it, till you experience it, it's not the same. It's so different that the apostles, the ones who have been studying with him, have him right in front of their face, just can't get it. Because when it goes from being just in the Word of God to being experienced in your life, it goes, well, I read about that. He taught about that. He told us about that. But then when it happens, it changes everything. Because our God, it takes so little. Billions of people and me. That's little. 5 minutes. Out of that, now. A worry that's big to me, but in all reality, it matters not. God can do a million other things. The fact that I'm concerned about my shoes. The fact that I'm concerned about the littlest thing in my life. I'm worried about losing my keys. The God of the universe who owns everything and is taking seeds and making them giant trees, and I'm talking about those keys that I can't find because I lose them every day. And admit, most of it's true. We do. We lose something and it's just the end of the world. And it is. It always is. Especially when it's your phone or your keys. And you've lost it, and you imagine this God who is greater than time itself and rules the world, and we're sitting there going, help me find my keys. We find our keys and we forget we prayed about it. We forget that we petition the God of the universe to help us find those things. We forget that we moved heaven with a little prayer about keys. And then we look at the church and we're sitting there going, yeah, you know, it's nice we get together, and we're not looking at it going, that little petition about keys moved heaven. Hey, let's sit here. Let's enjoy sitting here. Let's enjoy our quiet lesson. And the lessons are a lot like the parables. It is. The more we preach and teach here at this church, it still comes down to that same thing. The apostles started teaching and preaching and all of those things. And yet when they chose to experience something, they're in the midst of the storm, and you know what? It's a legit storm. There are problems in their life. They haven't just lost their keys. They're thinking they're going to die, and they're in the middle of a problem, and you know what they do? They do the greatest thing. Now, they have no faith. We figured out the apostles are terrible at having faith. And they don't believe and don't understand, but they do the greatest thing in the midst of lack of faith. Jesus, they wake him up. He is sleeping. Can you imagine that? You're getting a good sleep, and it's a rocky boat, so just rocking you to sleep. You know, it's like that little baby in the back of the car. You ain't going to wake him for nothing. And you got Jesus just resting. I mean, you know he's been teaching and working and walking. You know he needs that rest. And you know, they don't even consider that. They wake him up. They petition Jesus and say, do you not care? We're going to die. And even in their lack of faith, they still say, there's a storm going on. Jesus, do something. He's taught them that he can do mighty things. And they ask it. And that's the crazy thing. They ask for something, and then I love their response. Wait. He can actually... Wait. The wind and the sea obey him? I know we just asked God to do something, and he did it. But we didn't actually think it would happen. And too often our prayers consist of that, well, I don't think God would. and ask him to do something about something he can't handle. And yet we understand that God is all-powerful. We have these stories about Jesus healing storms and healing lepers and doing mighty deeds. And we sit here and go, God, that's a big prayer for you. Stick with keys and stuff. Stick with stuff that I know you can. Don't ask for anything so great that you have to look at it and go, whoa, who are you again? Like I thought I figured out who God was, and now I'm just looking at you going, you did that. The God who specifically says that we get to move heaven. Who specifically says that that power rests in us. Who specifically gives us all this authority, and all we want to do with it is find our keys. But this is a real prayer. This is a real prayer. I am in the middle of something, and I don't care if I think God will take care of it. I don't even have the faith to ask. I'm going to ask anyway. I don't have the faith to do what God says, but I'm obedient. I know that God wants me to do it, and I'm like, God, I can't do it. I don't care if you're with me. I'm going to do it. I got a problem here, and God, I'm not really convinced you're that big, but I don't care, it's coming to you. Because the great thing about God that isn't shown in the humanity of Christ is the fact that he doesn't sleep. We don't wake him up. When they're insulting the false prophets in the Old Testament, he says, maybe they're sleeping. The joke is, our God never sleeps. Maybe he's relieving himself. Our God never has to do that either. Maybe you need to scream louder. He's just not hearing you. Our God is not deaf at all. And hears our thoughts and our minds and everything we present to him. And it is so easy to just not give it. Or ask for things we know we can give. Instead of asking for things that actually require the movement of heaven and earth. Because we forget how many things require that in the first place. How many things does God have to change to affect one moment right now? If I ask for God to keep me safe, he's got to affect that heart that's going to risk my life. He's got to affect that situation in the past to fix that moment right now. And if we are not open to planting a mustard seed. That's all the faith we got. That tiny mustard seed. Saying, God, I don't have enough faith that this will actually be done. I don't have enough faith. I don't have enough anything. Here it is, God. I'm still going to ask for it. I don't have the faith that says, like, you can do this, but you know what? I'm still going to do it. I don't have the faith that says, God, you can get me through this, but I'm still going to do it. Because we face so many situations, and it just comes down to this. Well, I don't have enough faith. If God helps my faith, I'll do it. No! Forget about it! You got this faith of a mustard seed, it ain't going to work out real well. That's all you get. But if you trusted God, and only trusted him with the faith that you already have, and you say, God, I trust you with it, you know, I hope it works out. And then you watch. And you wait, and God does mighty things with it. And God produces shoots, and then he produces fruit, and then you're just like, whoa, 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 this was a tiny seed. And then you're looking at this tree. And you're going, where did that tree come from, God? Where does my kingdom stop? Because his kingdom is this. His kingdom is given to us in his church. And the question is, where does his church stop? It's not a matter of, do you have enough faith? Everybody makes it about faith. It's a matter of, do you have enough obedience? Because all the faith you have is that mustard seed. Are you faithful enough to take that tiny bit of faith you have and just say, that's all I got for you. You're my father. That's all I got for you. God, I'm going to use it. I'm going to plant this tiny bit of faith that honestly I could have just thrown out and not noticed. It's so small. I'm going to give you all of that. Sorry, God. I apologize again for my lack of faith. But God, I'm going to give you all of that. I'm going to be obedient with that tiny bit of faith And then when you do something, I'm probably going to be just like your apostles and go, God, what was that? That was amazing. All I gave you was that tiny bit of faith. And instead of looking at it and saying, when I've got enough faith, I'll do things for God. Or when I've got enough faith, or beat yourself up over your lack of faith. Be obedient with your lack of faith. Be obedient in the fact that Jesus says to his apostles, they have no faith. Have you still no faith? And all he's asking for is that tiny bit of seed of faith to be given to him. Because I can look at my faith and say, it's not good enough for you, God. I can stick it in my pocket. And it makes a terrible tree. It makes nothing. It just makes dirty laundry. Or I can take that seed and say, God, this is nothing. God, I should be giving you so much more, but I'm going to give you this tiny little bit. I'm going to be faithful with just a little bit, and I'm going to see what you're going to do. And I'm not going to give you prayers that consist of God if you can. I'm not going to give you prayers that say, I think this is in your power to do. I'm not going to give you prayers that say, you know, if you don't have to, you know, break all my traditions and, you know, do a miraculous work or any of that, God, then please do something with this. And if I say instead, I just say, God, do something great. God, move in a way that I go, what in the world are you doing? And I am confused and lost, and I want to be so dazed. I'm like, I am truly a child of yours right now. It doesn't make any sense. And I'm excited, and I'm on fire, and I'm watching this little seed become this giant tree, and I'm going, how is this happening to me? I gave you a seed, not a tree. I didn't have enough faith to give you a whole tree. And when God asks for our faith and to be obedient with our faith, then God is saying, take your mustard seed and give it to him. Plant it. Serve him today through obedience. And say, God, I don't have the faith to do what I'm doing. And I'm fine with that. I'm fine with the fact I don't have enough faith to do the kind of things you do. I don't have enough faith in you to see the things that you do. But God, I'm going to be obedient and wait for you to do something with that tiny bit of faith. Today we offer an invitation. The invitation is this, that God can take you, your tiny bit of faith, grow his church, and then as his church to be on power, empowered, and filled with his spirit. And through this, he offers this belief in his son, that Jesus is Lord. This repentance of our sins, knowing that we are wicked and he is a God who can cleanse. This confession that we are not ashamed, we're confessing as Lord. This baptism into his death so that we can be raised into his life. And we can live by the power of his Holy Spirit, which we don't have enough faith to figure out. So that we can live the rest of our life just being obedient and watching God do mighty things and going, I don't know how to happen. We also offer that invitation of a God who wants us back. God, we may have been faithful in the past, but we know there's something in our life that we need to give over to him, and we really want prayers for that. Or if there's anybody who wishes to submit to the eldership here, they're asked to come now as we stand. As